stuff.
Okay. All right. Hello, Sunrisers Book Club members. It's Gia.
Hi. And Jen.
And Jen.
Good morning.
Good morning. And thanks for joining us. Today, we are so, so excited because we have an author with us. So we've been reading American Harvest, God, Country, and Farming in the Heartland by Marie Masuki Mockett. And Marie is here to join us today. Marie, thanks for being here.
Good morning.
Thank you so much for having me. Good morning.
And Marie woke up early. Yes, and Marie woke up early. She's on the West Coast in San Francisco. So we so appreciate you waking up early and giving us the time.
Oh, I'm very excited to be here. I was thinking that my father would have said to me, that's not early, that's from Farmers Guild.
Okay, so we've been reading your book, American Harvest, which is really fascinating. It kind of takes you through the wheat harvesting that happens from Texas all the way to Idaho. And you spent a whole summer with some of these farmers who are mostly all evangelical Christians, yes?
Yes, yep, that would have been the summer of 2017. Actually, we began in May, so technically, I guess, spring.
Wow.
That's when wheat harvest starts and first ripens in Texas. And so they moved their equipment from Pennsylvania all the way down to Texas and then we did it.
So tell us a little bit about how this even got started, the idea of writing this book, because your story is your family has owned this farm for more than 100 years, and you decided one summer after talking to Eric, one of your family, longtime family friends, that he said, hey, you should come, and you did.
I think I should say that I always tell students that my books have kind of two levels of preparation. Usually there's an idea that has been germinating for a long time, and that was the case with American Harvest. I think maybe 18 years ago now, when my father was still alive and I was in Nebraska for harvest, I looked around and I thought, this world is so fascinating. And I was living in New York City at the time, and I thought, nobody knows anything about any of this, these machines, the cycle of a season, how the grain moves from one part of the country to the other. This would make a really interesting book. And so I kind of had that passing thought. And then when my father passed away in 2008, that idea took on greater urgency because I thought, I don't know what he's been doing all this time. And Eric and a couple other farmers went out of their way to really try to educate me in this kind of crash course in what farming is. And then finally in 2017, really things came together, and Eric, who had seen the Donald Trump phenomenon happening and had felt pretty certain that he was going to win the election. Remember, you know, where I was, nobody thought that Donald Trump had a chance of winning, but Eric thought he did and said, well, why don't you come on the road, you know, because we need to find a better way for all of us to communicate. And so this was our effort. Our idealistic effort.
Yeah. And Marie, it's Jen, and that was one of the most compelling parts of this book for me is, I mean, after Donald Trump won the presidency, I feel like there were like a million and one think pieces written by, you know, every publication you could think of with authors most likely on one of the coasts. And they all kind of went down to like this question of like, how could this happen? How did he win, you know? And I feel like that your book just took such a deep dive into what is often referred to as this divide in our country between where you live, what you do, what you believe in, your faith. And I wonder, you know, you do reference Donald Trump in your book, but by no means is that like a central, you know, component. But do you think, you said you did this in the summer of 2017, would you have done this book if Donald Trump had not been elected?
I think that I would have. Now, what's interesting is I started asking questions like, why are all these farmers I know who are Christian, why are they using GMOs? And then I have all these friends in the city who are atheists or who left their family of origin and don't practice any form of faith and who want organic food. There seems to be a tension there. And that's how I was framing it. And it was Eric, actually, who said, you know, you're not talking about science versus religion. You're not talking about Christianity at all. He said, you're talking about the divide. He was the one who first named it. And I thought, oh, that's what that is. And you know, the truth is, obviously, Donald Trump has come and gone, and we're here. Now we have new challenges. But the divide is a very real thing, and it's very deep, and it hasn't gone away. We see that now, right? Yeah. In conversations around things like vaccination. And so this is why I think what Eric was able to see and share with me is so powerful. And he's able to do that probably because he's driving repeatedly the same part of the United
right.
States over and over and over again and talking to people and really listening and hearing what they have to say. And so for him, the divide was very real, and he could point out places where he would see this tremendous cultural difference.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I probably would have, because you know, it's still there, right? It
yeah.
isn't as though we have our next election and then our tensions are wiped away. That's not what happens.
Right. And so Marie, people who didn't read this book, who are tuning in right now, they might not know mm-hmm. that you yourself are openly pretty liberal, you say, on the spectrum.
And so you
hang out with all these more conservative folks, farmers, for the summer. And was it, there were some moments where there was some frustration from you internally. Tell us mm-hmm. about some of the challenges, even talking to some of these folks who talked about religion or sexual orientation or, you know, some of the things that you didn't agree with.
I mean, I knew that there were going to be these divisions where we have very different ideas. But I was lucky in that there were enough people on the crew who always wanted to engage in conversation or were curious enough about me that I felt like the conversation was always moving forward, or mm-hmm. at least it was always going someplace. And I tried to, when speaking with people, ask questions. I kept thinking there's got to be something behind the first answer that I'm going to get.
Mm-hmm.
You know, most of the time we only have time for one answer. You know, do you support Black Lives Matters? Yes or no? And then, mm-hmm. you know, and then the conversation dies. And so I thought there has to be more and more and more behind the answer that I'm going to get. And so that's what I was always aiming toward.
Yeah.
But you're right, it could get really uncomfortable. And very, very distressing
yeah.
and very upsetting. And it can make you feel incredibly vulnerable, which is not a very comfortable feeling to have.
But I was also, you're right, when you are in those spaces where you don't feel like you can express yourself and you're kind of jumbling your thoughts around, because the people can be so knowledgeable about where they stand. But mm-hmm. I was surprised how open people were in terms of talking and also their questioning of how they interpreted Bible scripture, you know. So I was surprised that there were a couple of people that were in your orbit during this whole wheat harvesting season that they were questioning a lot.
Yeah, they were. Well, I mean, I think one of the things I learned and one of the things I was told, and I didn't take it, I just sort of filed it away because I didn't know how true it was, is that people are always questioning.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you can kind of see this play out in politics, right? In that the party who's in charge is always changing. It isn't the case that one party gets the presidency and always has that role. And it was very interesting for me during the 2020 election to see how in the news we focused on a couple of states, you know, and 10,000 voters in one state who made the difference. And I thought, oh, that's, you're seeing that questioning in action. People do wonder all the time, what do they really think? What do they really want to support, et cetera? There is actually tremendous flexibility in people's minds.
Mm-hmm.
That's not the way the story gets told. And so I did run into a lot of that and learn that people are always doubting. Doubt is a theme in American Harvest, this question of doubt. And people have a lot of doubt. And of course, it's also why powers that are in control have such a strong hand, because they know that around them are people who are doubting, who aren't
mm-hmm.
necessarily going to toe the party line. So I just tried, at least in my approach, to be open and to try to go to that place where someone was doubting and find out why they were doubting. And the book does detail a lot of that process, that internal process that people have.
Mm-hmm.
Marie, Jen here, were you surprised by, I'm thinking of Justin here, he's one of the farmers here in the book. Were you surprised
he's
by
so
how
great.
Much, yeah, he sounds like it. Were you surprised by how much he opened up to you? Because he spoke about some very personal things to you, about his own
mm-hmm.
doubts, you know, believing in his faith, believing in God.
I was very surprised. And over time, what I have come to understand, I mean, it's partly a question of character, but I actually really have come to understand that, you know, for Eric and Justin, both who are extremely open, it actually is the strength of their faith that allows them to be open. I think Justin in many ways struggles with more doubt than Eric. I don't necessarily know that that's true, but I think that that's the case. Mm-hmm. Justin is, if there's anybody out there who's, you know, a millennial and who's an evangelical who's doubting, his path, the way that his thinking expresses itself will be very familiar. You know, if God is supposedly supposed to love all of us, then, you know, why does it matter if I go to church? And this is a question that apparently people who are young are asking themselves all the time, because Jesus never said you have to go to church.
Yeah,
that's something that was grafted onto our belief system later. And so I was really surprised, but I think he also sort of has this internal sense of who he is that makes him feel okay with then expressing what it is that he really thinks, even if what he thinks is doubt. And Eric was the same. And, you know, it's really, neither of them were happy about the 2016 election, but they did handle it kind of differently than some of my peers, who every morning were, you know, looking at the paper and what terrible thing happened today, and then let me get on social media and talk about the terrible thing that happened today. Almost as though the right person needs to have the presidency for me to feel okay about myself and my place in the world. And I didn't really see Eric and Justin behave in that way. Like, they had an essential sense of self that transcended what was in the headlines. I found that really, they might disagree with me if they were here, because they don't like it when they're, you know, sort of cited as models in any way. But I found that really interesting, and I can't help but think that that's something that comes from their faith, like a sort of certainty somewhere.
And Marie, it's Gia here. I know that you didn't grow up evangelical Christian,
no.
According to this book.
No, in fact, I went to church and thought, oh, this is going to be interesting or boring. And I left church thinking, I have no idea what happened.
Right.
I can't understand anything. It's like a foreign language.
Yeah. And so, but you did go to a couple of churches while you were on the road with the different farmers. And there was one experience where you were weeping by the end of this church service. So can you talk a little bit about some of the things that you felt as you were going to church, even though you didn't grow up in this culture, in this religion?
Well, I mean, I was really lucky. I'll just say very quickly that I did get to go to a variety of churches, from what we call home church, where there's no pastor, where it takes place in a home, and to different country churches, Mormon temple, and then the incident that you're describing took place in a megachurch, one of these huge churches with sound,
right,
a sound system and light
in Oklahoma.
You know, yes, it was an amazing, and I think that was maybe the second or third mega church. Mm-hmm. And Justin had been taking me to churches, actually. When I would see him on a Sunday, we would sort of figure out where we could go within that Sunday. Like, can we get to two services? If we go to the 8 o'clock here, then we can get to the 11 o'clock across town over there. And so that day we did go to the mega church, and, you know, that kind of a church is designed to move someone like me. The messages are delivered in plain English without this, something that would require additional translation, and they're designed to address any insecurity or spiritual need or hunger or sorrow that I might be having, so that I can feel like that's a place that I can go to feel better. And they're incredibly beautifully choreographed. The staging is amazing. The directing is amazing. You have different people who come out, and there's like the main pastor who comes out, but then there are warm-up pastors. And so the coordination of it, it's like a theatrical event. It was amazing. It really impressed me. I try to go to a lot of theater, and so seeing something at that level that's a church really blew me away. So, you know, and that Sunday experience is there to give people, you know, many different things, but it sets the week off, and you're supposed to be in this, leave it in this correct frame of mind. Mm-hmm. And so I, you know, it was impossible not to be affected by that to some degree, particularly the music.
Yeah.
Eric, Justin, the other farmers who you accompanied that summer in 2017, what has their reaction been to this book?
Well, Eric and Justin love the book. They did read it before it was published. They're very supportive. Justin continues to really, he's grown a lot. It's been 4 years since that particular road trip. But they continue to support it. I think for some of the other farmers, it's difficult. They had a different experience, the one that I wrote. But you know, Eric is very interesting. He says to me, look, you know, these are very young people who are on the road, and you have to assume and expect that everyone will have been changed in some way mm-hmm. by this experience. And that may not be something that I hear about necessarily. But Eric and Justin too both have been very changed by that time on the road. I mean, that's what happens when you spend time with people who are quote unquote different or other. You know, you can't help if you can, I guess, defend yourself and spend the entire experience trying to, you know, say that your worldview is correct. But this is the power even of just traveling, like true traveling, where you're in a foreign country, you know. It challenges who you are and makes you need to soften in some way to listen to other points of view.
Right.
And so that's kind of what he said. And I hadn't thought about that. It was very important to Eric and Justin. They kept saying, well, no, these people are here to learn from you too, Marie, you know.
Wow. I do want to talk because you talk about differences too, and you know, one of the differences outwardly is your appearance as an Asian woman myself, and I've lived in white spaces for the last 12 plus years. Mm-hmm. Talk a little bit about going to some of these different locations and some of the things that you experience, because in your book you write about a woman telling you at one point, she said, don't ever let anyone tell you otherwise about how you look, that you're beautiful.
Yes.
Or something like that. And
yes.
You thought about that for a little bit. Can you talk about the experiences and how that changed your frame of thinking and just your outward appearance?
You know, it's so funny, Gia. I realize I have been thinking and writing about race for such a long time. But like you, I spend so much of my time in white spaces, and I'm of mixed race, and someone might look at me, it happened to me just the other day that somebody said, I mean, no offense, but I look at you and you just look white to me. And I said, I received that because I've heard that before.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm very fully aware of the fact that how other I'm going to look is going to depend on the context that I'm in and space that I'm in. And trying to control that just would drive me crazy. And so sometimes I'll be in a situation and something will happen and I'll think, oh, it's that thing. I've registered as other in this space, you know, or in that space I look white. But I felt so naked. I felt mm-hmm. so exposed that I really had to use language to describe what that experience was. And I was kind of humbled and I don't quite know what the right word is after I said I have to use language, that I couldn't avoid thinking what was happening or what my experience were as anything other than a part of what it is to be a certain race. And what the story is of the different races in this country. Mm-hmm. I feel, you know, I'm being completely honest in saying this, I feel a little ashamed that it took me so long in the process of going on the road to understand that, embrace that. In other words, mm-hmm. I didn't start out thinking, I'm a person of mixed race, and how are they gonna react to me? You know,
right.
I thought it's my job to go and listen and observe and try to understand and collect data and collect stories. Except I wasn't having the same experience that, you know, that Ian Fraser had when he wrote his wonderful book, The Great Plains, because people didn't look at me and see Ian Fraser, they saw something
right.
else. And so their responses to me were different. And so that's why the book has a very different texture. And I think that there's a lot of sort of negotiating that I do in my head all the time that I wasn't even aware of, that I had to stop doing and that I had to be honest about in order to write American Harvest. And that was a really kind of a humbling experience. Probably people of color know what I'm talking about, people of color who are always doing that and negotiating and are conscious of it. That may have been very obvious to them. In some ways, it was less obvious to me. But I didn't think about, for example, every hotel I walk into, in the back of my mind, I'm probably thinking, and how are they going to see me this time? Mm-hmm. Oh, that's how they see me this time. Okay, mm-hmm. Then I have to be like this. And I didn't, that's not in the book, but I don't think that I realized how much I do that.
Yeah, I feel that.
Right? You know, and then there's the, I remember walking into a hotel in Wyoming and the woman behind the counter was Native. Well, this actually happens in Idaho where they're Native American. And I thought, oh, they're going to see me. They're going to see the Japanese side. They're not going to know that I'm Japanese, but that's the person they're going to see. Or they might, they won't look at me and think I'm purely white.
Right.
And indeed, and I, but then nothing happened for a long time until later on in my stay, I was invited to the Sundance, you know, and I thought, oh, I've been seen and identified in this way.
Right.
That's what's happened this time.
With, I mean, without not giving too much of it away, do you feel that you've overcome that? Because that was a really vulnerable time for you. You were running back to your car saying, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. But do you still think about that moment and how has it changed for you?
Oh, absolutely. I think about the moment. You know, the funny thing, so that section I think is really powerful. Something very embarrassing or shameful potentially happens. And the first thought that went through my mind was, well, I just won't put that in the book. You know, nobody has to know that that happened. And then I thought, well, no, that has to go into the book. Can't leave anything out. And I absolutely continue to think about it. And I do have friends who are Native American. And so I've had conversations with them about that entire experience. And they, you know, mostly they just listen. You know, it deepened my understanding of certainly of the history of our country and of how complicated it is for us to interact with each other. Just in a nutshell, that's like the simplest way that I can put it. And so, you know, it's good that it happened in the sense that it made me think even more deeply about all of these things.
Right. And just for really logistical, practical question here, because Jen and I were talking this morning that you have, in this book, he was seven, your son, who was a seven-year-old, but Jen is a mother of two, and she was like, how did you do that?
It was May through October, right? I'm thinking, like, this is a huge commitment. My goodness, Marie.
Yeah, it was a huge commitment. He was awfully nice about it. When we talk about mommy going off someplace else to write, it's usually now in the context of Ewan coming along too. He came to see me a couple of times that are not in the book. There was a whole section in Texas where he came and it simply got excised because there was no reason to, you know, interrupt the narrative flow and say, and now we have a special visit from the writer's son. But there were moments where his experiences were so powerful and demonstrated things. For example, the scary church, when we went to the scary church, I was surprised by, and my son came and went with me and was terrified. And it really made it clear for me what the role of fear can be in religion and church and how that shapes people's group behavior and their dynamics and why they might continue to support something that they know is wrong. It's because they've been taught to be afraid from the time of childhood. So that, you know, that example was so powerful. I kept that in the book. But he would come and visit. My husband would come, and then they would go back to California. And there is actually a point also where I went back to California to be with him, and then went back on the road. But you know, I was gone a lot, and I just really wanted to do this project.
Yeah. I know we're running out of time here, but I did appreciate all the different facts about the Mennonite community too, because my partner grew up Mennonite. He's Mennonite Brethren. And so he and I have been talking a lot about this, and he has done a lot of research. He went to school studying the history of his own people. And so, so talking to him about some of the things I was reading in the book was just really fascinating for me. So thanks for including that.
Oh, I mean, I had a wonderful church experience in Oklahoma. I think that you may be talking about that. Yeah, so the Mennonite Church is a really interesting church, and it's a very interesting denomination. And but it's one of the, I think it's one of those churches that didn't necessarily try to seize any political power. Mm-hmm. So, which is a good and a bad thing, because then we don't hear about them quite so much the way that you would about the Catholic Church,
right?
Or some of the Protestant denominations. And in the Brethren in Christ, which is what Eric and Justin belong to, are the same. So you don't even, I never even heard of this denomination until I met them.
Yeah.
But they have a very, they try to retain a very sort of, what did Jesus really say, relationship to Christianity. And so, you know, that leads to all kinds of interesting conversations that yeah. are also meaningful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Can you tell us anything else you're working on before we let you go?
Well, I completed a novel during the pandemic. My tour for American Harvest was jettisoned, and so there I was in front of Zoom. So I wrote a novel, which is which I'm kind of reading through one more time, and I've got a series of essays on California that are supposed to come out called How to Be a Californian, and then I have other projects, that I have started.
Oh gosh, I want to read that book because I'm like, I'm from California, born and raised. So
it's kind of like, I'm sort of afraid now that I called it that, because I think we all know that anybody who's born and raised in California knows that this is like a pressing issue. And then I worry, like, can I possibly?
It's definitely an eye-catching headline, Marie.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you so much. Is there anything else that we haven't asked you that you want to just maybe put out there for the readers or the viewers?
Oh my goodness. I'm just really grateful to you for choosing this book. And I, you know, what we hoped the most, we did think the most that we could hope for is that the book will perhaps spark conversation.
Mm-hmm.
And so I thank you for, you know, for choosing the book and having conversations with each other. The book is not prescriptive, obviously. I don't think of myself as an authority, but thank you so much for having conversations around the themes that are raised in the book and for being open to it.
I think there's a good lesson to be had mm-hmm. here about how to speak with people.
Yeah.
And, to be compassionate to people who maybe don't come from the same walk of life as you.
Right. I appreciate
and I,
that.
I'll also say, you know, there were people who said, I don't want to pick up your book because there are too many stars on the cover. But, you know, it is everyone's country. Everyone who's here, it's our country.
So. Right.
Yeah.
Well, American Harvest, God, Country, and Farming in the Heartland by Marie Mutsuki Mockett. You can pick it up at your local bookstore, online, I imagine. Thank you so much for joining us.
So appreciate your time, Marie.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you so much. It's my pleasure. Thank you. Have a good day.
Thank you.
Bye.
Okay.